We're here with Michael Shermer. He's the founder of the Skeptic Society and Skeptic Magazine. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Hope so. So first question for you. Why is skepticism such a passion of yours? I mean, you founded a relatively active organization, Fantastic Magazine. There has to be something driving that.
Well, my motivation is teaching critical thinking and pro-science, science education. And so Skeptic Magazine and my column, say, in Scientific American called Skeptic, deals with fringe areas, margins of science that, say, Scientific American normally wouldn't cover in the rest of their articles in that magazine. So Skeptic Magazine does what, say, Scientific American would not do, and my column in Scientific American does what the other articles would not do, which is that we deal with claims that normal scientists who are busy with their own research don't have time to deal with. Like the climate deniers or the evolution deniers, Holocaust deniers, fringe groups, cults, UFOs, these things. The SETI scientists, astronomers, cosmologists, they don't have time to deal with UFO people. That's sure. Our job. But where the deeper passion is understanding the psychology of belief, why people believe these things.
Yeah, I've written several, at least one book about how we believe. I believe that's exactly what it's called, and great book also. Some consider skeptics to be the guys who, so to speak, spit in the soup. What do you think of the social benefits of skepticism?
Well, to the extent that you think living in a real world is important, that's what we do, a reality-based world instead of a faith-based world, but however you want to put it, we live in the age of science, not pseudoscience. We're not living in the Middle Ages with witchcraft and so on, but nevertheless, there's still claims that are along the lines of the paranormal and the supernatural, and although rates of belief compared to the Middle Ages are much lower, still quite a few people believe these things, even in age of science. So really, all we're doing is, there's nothing special about skepticism, it's just science. Scientists are skeptics. Science itself is a form of skepticism. So all we're doing is saying, hey, let's apply the methods of science that everybody already agrees is good. Science-based medicine is better than non-science-based medicine. Everybody wants to go to a real doctor and get real medicine and so on. So we're just saying apply that across the board in all claims.
So I guess the benefit to society then is if we're using things that are based on reality, we're going to be bettering ourselves in general.
Well, that's the idea behind Jefferson's educated populace for a democracy to work. You need an educated populace. You need the rational voter to be able to not just read and write. You should be literate, of course, but also how to think. Mm-hmm. So it's reading and writing and thinking critically. That's important for a civil society to function. So the big thing, on the grand scale to make the world a better place, science is a very important tool.
I absolutely 100% agree with you, obviously. What is new with the Skeptic Society nowadays?
Well, our latest thing is we have been dealing with gun control, climate deniers, gender differences. We're really dealing with controversial political issues now. We've debunked the paranormal 1,000 times. There's only so many variations on a theme to do that. So we're looking for other areas to be skeptical in. So that's a new thing. Our whole baloney detection kit and other things like that. We have a little kit for dealing with climate deniers. We're producing a series of educational videos, like the Khan Academy videos, how to be a con artist. Basically showing the tools of this. And so we have a series of those coming out. I'm teaching a course in Skepticism 101 at Chapman University. I taught a course for the teaching company that you can go to teach12.com or the great courses, and you can take my course in Skepticism 101. You don't have to go to a university and pay all that money. You can get it for much cheaper on the teaching company. And we have Skepticism 101 webpage with free resources for teachers on how to teach their own Skepticism 101 courses. So the whole thing is science education.
That's absolutely wonderful to hear. That's all that's going on.
The next thing is to make Skepticism 101 course a MOOC. A MOOC is a massive online open course. So instead of having, I'm going to have like 35 students at Chapman take my course, I should have 35,000 students taking this course.
Yes, you should.
And through the wonders of photography and YouTube, online courses are happening now.
Yeah, and I think they're better than, how they used to be, say, 5, even 10 years ago. Yeah. They're obviously because of the internet becoming faster and better, more user-friendly people. We can exchange these ideas much better, and I think that's very important. So you are Mr. Deity on an episode dealing with monosexuality.
Yes.
what's it like to be on that, to be on his show?
You know, it's a show. You got to memorize your lines, and there's tons of takes, and it takes all day. But Brian is a brilliant genius. He is very creative. He's very funny and clever, but also very smart. And so all those Mr. Deity and the Way of the Mister, they all have actually a really deep, important message that's in there. It's just that he's delivering it in a way that's funny, so you're sort of, you think, oh, that was funny, and then you think, wait, he actually is saying something really important there.
Sure.
So, you know, I think that's yet another tool to come at what we do.
And that episode, Drew, I thought you did brilliantly, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
You did a fantastic job.
I'm not a great actor, but I'm getting better.
Oh, I don't know that you had to act much. I mean, the character, I think you were coming off as the skeptic, right? Yeah, so, I mean,
right.
You know,
right? Well, I already do that for a living, yeah. Although, see, when they turn the cameras on and go, it's a completely different thing than you just sitting here asking me questions.
Oh, sure. Oh, of course. Yeah, you have, like you said, you have lines to say.
Right.
They have to be correct. Are you and Brian thinking of working on any future episode?
Well, we did the Khan Academy video. We just did the video on The Secret, The Law of Attraction. We debunked that. And so our next one, we're working on a script now on plotting 9/11 as an inside job.
Oh my!
We're the ones that actually did it. Yeah. So anyway, we'll have our little characters sitting in a darkened room or something, plotting how we're going to fly planes into buildings and plant explosive devices inside the buildings, and no one will ever know about it, and firing a cruise missile to hit the Pentagon, and how we're going to have to keep everybody quiet and no one talks. Anyway, we're just going to have this whole elaborate thing. Just to show how ridiculous conspiracy theories are.
Oh, of course. I'm on those people all the time. So last question. You're a prolific writer. Do you have anything coming up that's in the pipeline that maybe we should be looking for anytime soon?
Yep. So my next book is called The Moral Arc of Science, How Science Has Bent the Arc of the Moral Universe Toward Truth, Justice, and Freedom, and so forth, all the good things we like. And basically it's saying that the Enlightenment program continues, it should continue, it was the right direction to take. And by science, I mean not just experiments and lab coats, I mean using reason, logic, empiricism, the whole thing as a worldview. And I think that's the best hope we have for humanity.
This might be a fairly strange question. Sam Harris came out with The Moral Landscape, mm-hmm. where he argues that science can give us morality, or at least mm-hmm. Show us that there are things that are more objectively moral than others. Are you piggybacking on that, or is it
yep.
a different angle?
Nope, that's right. I mean, using science to determine right and wrong is part of my next project.
Awesome.
Yep.